Good morning, Vandal. Today we are going to discuss briefly about naive Bayes classifier. Let's try to recall minimum array classifier, which is also named as map classifier or Bayes classifier. Let's consider C classes for classification tasks. And the class labels are omega1 to omega C, and the input feature vector is D cross 1 dimensional vector. Prior probabilities of the classes are P of omega j, j equals to 1 to c. And the likelihood functions are represented by fx bar of x bar after omega j for all j equals to 1 to c. Let I star equals to arg max of P of omega j, fx bar of x bar after omega j. Then omega I star is the optimal class corresponding to the given input feature vector x bar. Is a map classifier, imagine a posteriori probability classifier. This corresponds to a posteriori probability, proportional to a posteriori probability, and we are then maximizing this a posteriori probability. Whichever class is trying to give the maximum value for the a posteriori probability, that class will consider as our output class to the given input x bar. That's what we are doing here. But in order to do this one, we should have the better estimates for the prior probabilities and the likelihood functions that is required. It means at first we need to estimate prior probabilities and the conditional distributions. In most of the real world problems, we can have good estimates for the prior probabilities, but it's not possible to get good estimate for the likelihood functions with the available training data. Because our training data is limited, we may require huge amount of training data in order to train our joint distributions. Let's have a look into this curse of dimensionality. You can try to have a look into this one. When we are having only one feature, when we are having two features with us, when we are having three features with us. And let's try to follow that histogram method in order to find the concerned probability density functions for the or likelihood functions. For example, if you try to divide this 0 to 1 interval, let's assume that we have normalized our feature to 0 to 1 interval, and after that we are trying to divide that into 5 parts, 0 to 1 interval, like 0 to 0.2, 0.2 to 0.4, 0.4 to 0.6, 0.6 to 0.8, 0.8 to 1. We have partitioned that into 5 parts. It means we need to estimate 5 parameters. Probability that one parameter is probability that x belongs to 0 to 0.2, and second parameter we need to estimate is probability that x belongs to 0.2 to 0.4, like that. We need to estimate 5 such parameters. When d equal to 1, when d equals to 2, when d equals to 2, we can try to see, and once again try to split this 0 to 1 interval into 5 parts. This 0 to 1 interval into 5 parts. This is x1, this is x2 feature. There are two features, and total number of parameters that we need to estimate is 5 into 5. Total 25 combinations we are getting, right? Total 25 parameters we need to estimate. When we are having three features, x1, x2 and x3, d equals to 3. When we are having three features with us, then we need to estimate total 5 into 5 into 5. Total 5 cube, 125 parameters we need to estimate. Suppose if you are having 100 features with us, then we need to estimate 5 into 5 into, and so on. It implies that 5 power 100 parameters we need to estimate. That's so huge, right? In order to estimate that many number of parameters, you required a very, very huge amount of training data with us. That's impossible, right? And in order to reduce this complexity, or in order to reduce the requirement of training data in this one, what we are doing is we are trying to represent our, we are trying to approximate our likelihood functions with the help of some functions which can be represented as a function of lesser number of parameters. That's part our plan. For example, most of the practical distributions can be approximated roughly with jointly Gaussian, with mean mu bar and covariance matrix sigma 1. For example, when x bar is d cross 1 feature vector, we required in total d plus d into d plus 1 by 2 parameters in this model. These many number of parameters we need to estimate. As d is increasing, roughly the number of parameters required also increasing at a rate of order of d square. You can see this d square term is there, right? D square plus d by 2. As we increase d, we required more and more training data to estimate the parameter values properly. For example, just consider an example. Let's assume that our d equals to 100, d equals to 100. Then the number of parameters that we need to estimate with the help of that Petler slide using histogram method. If you go for 5 partitions for each feature, then 5 power 100 parameters you need to estimate. You need to estimate 5 power 100 parameters. Suppose these features x1, x2 and so on up to xd, d equal to 100, are independent features. Suppose if they are independent features, if they are independent, then no need to estimate 5 power 100 parameters. No need to estimate 5 power 100 parameters like this. Let's have a look into this. For example, if you are having x1 and x2, d equals to 2 case, right? No need to estimate all these 25 parameters, 5 square parameters. We can estimate these 5 parameters and these 5 parameters. That's more than enough. Because when coming to joint distribution fx1 x2 of x1 comma x2, that can be equal to product of marginals when they are independent. fx1 of x1 into fx2 of x2, that is equal to product of marginals. Then no need to estimate these joint probabilities straight away. We can estimate the marginal probabilities first. With the help of marginals, you can try to construct this joint distribution. It's just product of marginals, right? So for estimating this x1 feature marginal distribution, we required 5 variables, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 partitions. For estimating this x2 marginal PDF, we're trying to partition this into 5 parts, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We need to estimate 5 parameters. Once we got these 5 plus 5, 10 parameters, we can estimate these 25 parameters with the help of these 10 parameters. Just product of marginals, right? If I want this parameter, I can simply go for fx1 of this partition into fx2 of this partition or px2 of this one. Like that, I can find these things, right? Once I know this one. That's the way we are going to follow. You can find the marginals first. After that, you can go for multiplication. If they are independent, then we may need to estimate these many number of parameters. 5 plus 5 plus 5 and so on. 100 features are there, right? Just 500 parameters you need to estimate when they are independent. Because we need to estimate just marginal PDFs. Once you got marginal PDFs, you can find the joint distribution with the help of product of marginals, because they are independent, right? Instead of estimating these many number of parameters, 5 power 100 is very, very huge as compared to these 500 parameters. It means that independency assumption, or when the features are independent, that will simplify our problem a lot, right? We require less training data, very, very less training data as compared to that finding joint distribution straight away. That's the benefit we are going to get when the features are independent. And let's have a look into that parameterizing method with the help of Gaussian distribution. If you want to estimate joint distribution in that scenario, we have seen mean parameters are d plus these many covariance matrix parameters we need to estimate. The many number of parameters we need to estimate. For example, d equal to 100, 100 plus, for each likelihood function, the many parameters we need to estimate. 101 divided by 2,
this is equals to 100 plus 50 into this one, this is 5150. These many parameters we need to estimate. If you want to estimate that entire joint distribution, instead of finding joint distribution, suppose if they are independent, if all 100 features are independent and they are Gaussian, for each of the Gaussian feature, we need to estimate two parameters. One is mean, second one is variance, mean and variance. Total 100 parameters we are having. 2 into 100, when they are independent, independent Gaussian, when features are independent Gaussian, then these many parameters we need to estimate. These two corresponds to, one parameter is for mean, another parameter is for the variance. Total 200 parameters we need to estimate. This is much bigger as compared to 200, right? The number of parameters we are going to estimate is less, means with the help of less training data itself, we can try to estimate them very well as compared to this one. That's the benefit we are going to get with independent features. This naive Bayes classifier will take this as an advantage. It will try to assume that all the features are independent of each other. If they are independent of each other, we need to estimate very less number of parameters, which require less training data, right? Less amount of training data is enough in order to estimate them well. Naive Bayes classifier will make the assumption that for a given class, all the D features are independent of each other. That is, features are independent of each other when conditioned over class label. It's like fx bar of x bar after omega j equals to product of marginals. You can see product of marginal PDFs. Due to independency assumption, we can reduce the amount of training data required. In most of the practical scenarios, the independency assumption will be violated. However, naive Bayes classifiers still tend to perform exceptionally well. Reason for this one is, in most of the problems, given training data may not be enough, that's almost very less, in order to estimate the likelihoods properly, the giant likelihoods properly, giant probability density functions properly. Then independency assumption will work very well, finding marginal PDFs as compared to finding the giant distributions directly using that limited amount of training data. Anyhow, with the limited amount of training data, if you try to estimate the giant distributions directly without the help of marginals, then you won't get perfect giant distribution. You are going to get erroneous giant distribution, because that training data may not be enough, right, in order to estimate that entire giant distribution. Instead of doing in that way, it's better to have an assumption that all the features are independent of each other and try to find the marginals, then find the giant distribution with the help of product of marginals. This might be little bit better as compared to that bad PDF, bad giant distribution we are going to get. That's why in most of the practical scenarios, even though the features may not be independent of each other, this will work out as compared to that kind of bad PDF estimation with limited data, the giant PDF estimation. This approximation might good in most of the scenarios. That's why this will work out. If you are having very huge amount of data with you, then giant distribution looks good as compared to finding marginals and doing product of marginals. Naive Bayes classifier can handle missing data issues very well. If there is any missing feature in your training data, that can be neglected, because no need to worry about that one, right? For example, if you are having total 10,000 training samples with you, and out of 10,000 training samples, let's assume that around 50 training samples are missing first feature, x1 feature. With the help of remaining 950 samples, we can try to estimate the marginal PDF. No need to consider all 1000 features. That's the beauty of naive Bayes classifier. Similarly, suppose 30 features are missing, in 30 values are missing for feature 2 in your training data. 30 training examples are missing feature 2 in your training data. Then you can try to estimate your distribution, your Jahn distribution, with the help of remaining samples, remaining H2 samples. No need to worry about these samples. You can do this independently, right? All features you are finding the marginals independent of each other. That's the benefit you are going to get with naive Bayes classifier. Thank you.